रहमान रहीम स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी इमेजेस एंड इम्प्रेशंस. दिस इज द मेन टाइटल अंडर विच वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी थ्री शॉर्ट पोएम्स बाय बोथ ब्रिटिश एंड अमेरिकन पोएट्स. द थ्री पोएम्स दैट वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी अंडर दिस हेडिंग आर ऑटम बाय टी ई ह्यूम्स. ही इज अ ब्रिटिश पोएट, मॉडर्न ब्रिटिश पोएट. फॉग by Carl Sandburg, he is an American poet, and Metro Paris by Ezra Pound, who is an expatriate American poet, and he is also called the founder of, the father of Imagist movement. Imagism, before we begin with the poems, we first need to have an introduction of Imagism. Imagism is a literary movement. It's a movement in literature in early 20th century. Imagism is also given the credit for paving the way for modernist movement. The modernist movement, which spans almost the main part of 20th century. T.S. Eliot is the most important, well-known modernist poet. Imagism is given this credit for initiating the modernist movement. Now, discussing the main features of Imagism, As the title of the literary movement suggests, that the movement revolves around working and creating precise and vivid images. Vivid means clear images. And these writers are all about precision and clear, sharp and clear images. And those images, they believe, have to stand for themselves. They don't explain the images, they don't clarify the images. Their poems are very precise and brief, and that image, one image that they discuss, for example, in Autumn, this is an autumn night, and in the second poem, this is a, there is a the image of a fog compared with a cat. And in the third poem, metro, you know, is the underground tube station, jisko railway station kehte hain. Metro, the poem by Ezra Pound, the most famous expatriate American poet, is just a two-line poem, Metro. And that poem is set in the underground railway station. And that underground railway station becomes a symbol of modern man's existence. That explains the, that one image of an underground railway station explains the nature of human existence in modern times. So these are the three images explained in the three Imagist poems. Beginning with the first poem, Autumn, written by T.E. Humes, who is a British modern poet, and his contribution is quite important for the Imagist movement. And we should also remember that Imagism in literature is an Anglo-American movement. Anglo-American means both British and American movement. Both British writers and American writers have contributed to Imagism. T.E. Hume being one of the British writers. His poem is titled as Autumn. And he says in his poem, "A touch of cold in the autumn night. I walked abroad and saw the ruddy moon lean over a hedge like a red-faced farmer. I did not stop to speak, but nodded, and round about were the wistful stars, with white faces like town children." That's it. This is the poem Autumn. The poem is set in autumn night. The poet goes out in one autumn night for a walk. There is a touch of cold. You know, autumn is the season of fall. It just precedes the winter season. Autumn season, in autumn season, there is the touch of cold. One can feel the cold in the air. And the poet says that he walked abroad, he went out for a walk. And what does he see outside? Students, kindly remember that we have to write our analysis, literary analysis, in present tense. So the poet goes outside and he sees that there is the ruddy moon. Ruddy means healthy red color. The face of the moon is compared with the human face. Ruddy is the color of the face usually, healthy red color. And ruddy moon lean over a hedge, moon is leaning, bending over a hedge. So bending is a quality that personifies the moon, because human beings bend, moon cannot bend. The poet has compared moon with a human being, and the image becomes clear in the next verse, where he says, like a red faced farmer. Like should be encircled. Aap circle kar lein red like ko, because it is a simile. So the image of a moon leaning means bending over a hedge, is then likened with a farmer with a red face. Now red face has many healthy implications. Farmers, you know, live in connection with nature, they are serving nature, they are cultivating the land, they are exposed to the healthy sunlight, they are exposed to the physical labor, they come into contact with earth, with mud, with ground, and then all that balance of fresh air and sunlight and water and purity of the environment gives a healthy red color to the face of the farmer. And you should remember that here we are talking about the moon, and that image of a moon, ruddy moon, has been used to evoke the entire theme of the healthy conditions in the rural life. That you girls, you students need to notice. Next he says, I did not stop to speak but nodded. So he just greeted the moon, and he is treating moon as a human being. He is greeting the moon, and round about were the wistful stars. He moves on after greeting the moon with the gesture of the head. Up and down movement is called nodding. So he, with a gesture of a head, he acknowledges the moon, greets the moon, and moves on. And round about were the wistful stars. What do you see around the moon? The wistful stars. The stars are wistful. Wistful means sad. Now stars can be dim. That dimness can be called sadness, but stars cannot be sad. So when this quality of human quality of sadness is attributed to stars, we could safely say that stars have also been personified. And these stars look sad because they definitely are dim. When you look at the stars from a distance, they may look dim, they may be, the sky may be cloudy, there may be different reasons. Nevertheless, the poet calls stars sad, with white faces like town children. So here the theme of town children, the theme of urbanization has been introduced. So the poem is about the comparison between life in a village and life in a city. Town means city. And these wistful stars are compared with town children, children living in cities, because of their white faces. And you should encircle like here. Wistful stars have white faces. Wistful stars, first they are considered sad, they are called to be sad. Then they are compared with white faces like town children. So definitely wistful stars have also been personified. The moon has been personified having a red, healthy red colored face like a farmer. Stars have been personified like town children, children living in cities, having white faces, dim faces, sad, sorrowful faces. Or if you look at the previous comparison, we could call unhealthy complexion, unhealthy faces, because they are white, they are not as red, bright, vibrant, energetic as the face of the farmer who lives in the healthy environment in a village. So the theme of urbanization and rural life. In rural life, man lives in close contact with nature, and all that healthy environment in the villages, the pure air, the fresh water, the healthy exposure to sunlight are the factors that give a healthy look to the farmer. Whereas children living in the cities who are not blessed in the sense of having an access or exposure to the healthy sunlight because of, you know, the tall building blocks in the cities. The tall buildings, skyscrapers, we get there, skyrocketing, high-rising buildings, where the sunlight can hardly get through, where in the streets there is darkness, and these may be the children belonging to the lower strata of society, lower classes of the society, who are not enjoying the benefits of sun, the benefit of open places, grounds, playgrounds. Therefore, their faces are white, and as well as the theme of pollution, city in the cities there is pollution. There, the living conditions are not very healthy. So all these factors contribute to the children's white faces, which are not healthy, which are don't look healthy. In this poem, we all can observe that the poet hasn't used the word, the direct comparison between the city, life in a city, or life in a village, and without engaging in a direct comparison between two lifestyles, the poet has made his point through clear, precise images. Image of a moon, of a ruddy moon, leaning over a hedge, and image of the wistful stars with white faces like town children. So there you go, the next poem, Fog. Coming to the second poem, Fog, by the American poet Carl Sandburg, American modern poet, 20th century poet. The poem goes like this. The title is Fog, and you should start thinking about the symbolism in fog, the meaning of fog. The poet says, "The fog comes on little cat feet. It sits looking over the harbor and city on silent haunches, and then moves on." So this is a poem more brief, more precise than the previous one. The fog comes on little cat feet. You see, the comparison is direct. Fog is directly compared with little cat feet. So fog, on the one hand, has been personified as a cat, and the comparison being direct, it could also be taken as a metaphor. Fog is metaphorically, fog is moving like a cat on little feet. It sits looking. So fog can sit. That means fog has been given the qualities of a living creature, qualities of a cat who is a living creature, which sits. Fog cannot sit. Fog does not have feet. So when feet have been given to fog, fog sits looking, fog can sit, fog can look over the harbor. Harbor means seaport, over the harbor and city. So the fog is now looking, sitting and looking over the seaport and the city on silent haunches. On silent means sitting silently on its back legs, hind legs jo hoti hain, and then moves on. Maybe when the sun rises, the fog disappears. Moves on means the poem does not say disappears. I have said disappears. The poet says, and then moves on, gradually moves away, walks away. That reminds you of the image of fog as a cat. Fog comes on little cat feet. So you girls can see that the poet has compared fog with a cat, and the image is quite vivid, quite clear. Cat, fog moving like a cat on little feet, sits looking quietly, silently over the sea and the city, and then moves on. Here the image is complete. Now it is up to the readers to make the meaning of this poem. What could be the significance of fog? Fog, you see, is a climatic situation, atmospheric condition in which things are unclear, things become dim, things become vague, unclear. So this is the the literal meaning of fog. In literature, in modern writings, fog is compared with the human inability to see things clearly. Fog is a symbol of a lack of clarity. And lack of clarity about what? Lack of clarity about what is right and what is wrong. Lack of clarity about what is healthy and what is unhealthy. So again, this poem could be about the condition of modern man, who is modern existence is shaped by life in the cities. You can connect this poem here with the previous poem, Autumn, how the poet has evoked the image of harbor and city. You see, city is there, the theme of urbanization, that is there. And the cities enveloped in fog is a complete image in itself. That in the cities, people get disconnected with nature. The first and immediate comparison is that in the cities, people disconnected from nature. They live in the building blocks and they live, use the all types of machines to facilitate their life. And they do not get engaged with the outdoor activities very much. And they work in the offices, not like the farmers in the open fields, or facing the sun and facing the fresh water, breathing in the clean air. All these facilities are not available to the people living in the cities. So the first meaning could be modern humans becoming disconnected with nature. And that first disconnection, as I shared one quote with you in the WhatsApp group, students, okay, disconnection with nature also means disconnection with oneself, because human beings are part of nature. And when human beings cannot connect with nature, do not prioritize connection with nature, they get disconnected from themselves also. And then that disconnection is can be seen in the disconnection with other human beings, disconnection with, then that, of course, hukukulla. When human beings are not well connected with other human beings, then you see they become stressful and they become dissatisfied and unhappy in their lives. Because when one is connected with oneself, with others, with nature, with God, one lives a happy, peaceful, satisfied life, no matter how many difficulties one faces. Life is difficulties, challenges. These are the other names for life. Suffering is a part of life. Pain is a part of life. And as it is very rightly said, pain is inevitable. Suffering is a choice. Everyone has to go through pain. But who has the power and the courage to transform pain into a better understanding of life, into a better vision for themselves, for others? Those are the people who learn to live life meaningfully. Suffering is a choice. There are people who choose suffering, and they go into the victim mindset and they believe that they are always persecuted and they have no way out and they are trapped and they are the ones who suffer all the time. So these negative mindsets then are all directly connected. Anxiety, depression, dissatisfaction, all these negative mindsets are directly connected with the loss of self when human beings lose themselves. Therefore, then the increasing materialism, the race for more and more material possessions, more power, more success, more money, more popularity, superiority, control. And then in this rat race for success, there comes then materialism and exploitation of other people. You have read the poem yesterday, the hawk's monologue, how the hawk believes in exploitation. Hawk mindset represents the modern human's mindset also. When they lose the balance between body and soul, they become too materialistic. Then they want to have everything for themselves for selfish reasons, just like the hawk in that poem. And they would do everything, just like the hawk, to gain benefits for themselves. They may exploit, they may They may bully, they may control the natural resources, the other human beings, for their personal benefits. So fog in this poem shows the moral chaos. Chaos hota hai na, jab when things are not clear. The moral degeneration, the disconnection among human beings. And disconnection does not mean getting together, having parties together. Those parties need to have those connections, those get-togethers need to have a heart-to-heart spiritual connection as well. If the heart-to-heart spiritual connection is missing and just the superficial contact is being made in the name of food only, food is the only factor that joins the people, and there is no spiritual connection possible or available, or people are not even willing to make that spiritual connection, that meeting of the minds, meeting of the ideas, then of course no physical contacts would be fruitful. No physical contacts would bring peace and happiness to human beings. No get-togethers will bring permanent joy, a permanent source of thinking, reflection, happiness, satisfaction. Because people get together, they have food together, and then they go away. And often people arrange those get-togethers to see how they can manipulate those connections for their own benefits. How they can exploit each other's through those contacts. Nobody is interested in connection, in making real, genuine connection on the human level. So the people who seek making contacts with other people for the personal benefits, those are the ones who disconnect with others. And people who seek genuine connection, those are the people who are on the right path. People who do not engage in profound discussions about moral standards, about intellectual ideas, about growth, about healing ourselves, about evolution as a human being. Those people are a real threat to a healthy society. A healthy society can be formed only by those people who are genuine human beings, who cultivate genuineness, who prioritize truthfulness and kindness, companionship, equality, justice. Those are the people who can create a healthy life. That modern humans are so engaged in the physical world, and they are so interested in improving their bodies, making the bodies healthy, making their faces look pretty, making their bodies look pretty, physical exercises, face masks, facials, dresses, haircuts, everything is devoted to make the body beautiful. And they have forgotten how to make the soul beautiful. What makes the soul beautiful? The power of truth, the power of love. Wherever there is truth, there is love. And love and truth beautify the soul. Whenever there is less than truth, whenever there are half truths, that means that the love is missing. Love is the most important. We are all created to love. We are all created to speak the truth, to search the truth, to stand for truth, to speak the truth. And that is the only way to live in love. So when we live in love, our soul flourishes, our soul blossoms, and that shows on our bodies. We think that our bodies will look beautiful only with the help of beauty creams and beautiful dresses and beautiful hairstyles. But the beauty within, the spiritual beauty, glows when we live closest to truth. Living closest to truth means living closest to love, and that love reflects on your face. And that is real beauty, inside out, having one face inside out. One more important point here is that autumn is a symbol of fall. Autumn is also called the season of fall. The trees, the leaves fall, and the flowers do not grow. Not many flowers grow during the autumn season. Things are going towards the winter season. And winter season, you know, is also the season when everything becomes cold, and that cold weather is the coldness. The severe cold is the opposite of heat and life that we associate usually with the spring season, with the warmth of spring season, with the growth and maturity in summer season. You girls need to understand the symbolism of autumn, the symbolism of seasons. The symbolism of seasons is vital to understanding literature. And if we compare spring season with the new life, with new birth, we can compare spring season with the new life, birth, and summer season, maturity, growth. Then comes autumn, when the human life becomes, human beings lose their faculties, they start the faculties to hear, to see, hair fall starts, and teeth sometimes become weak. That's the fall, the decrease in human physical power. And then comes winter season. Winter season is the closure, the end of life. The cycle of life is completed. This is how you can see the symbolism in seasons. And according to this symbolism, autumn night, the poem is set in the autumn night. And this is a point of decline in human civilization. A point of decline where the people have settled in the urban areas and their children, the young generation, their future is living in unhealthy conditions. That's what the poem, there is a whole wealth of meanings in this poem. The more you read this poem, the more you explore the deeper meanings, you will come up with newer ideas.